hypoglycemia.
Thank you so much. Always a pleasure and a double-edged sword when you have as a chairperson. There's a huge risk of being ragged. Anyway, without much ado, I want to at the outset thank ACP India chapter team to have invited me here. And in particular, Dr. Amish Maheshwari sir, Dr. Jayant Panda sir, Dr. Srinivas Murthy, Dr. Supratik, and Dr. Nayak is also here. So thank you very much. Goa is a dream come true, and BC Roy room is another dream come true. Not all of us can get that award. So when it's difficult to treat, I'm going to give you a quick overview on the refractory hypoglycemia aspects. So what exactly is refractory hypoglycemia? Well, definitions are not exactly clear, but it has been described as either prolonged duration of hypoglycemia that's lasting from hours to days, need for high dose of dextrose, more than 30 grams of glucose to normalize the glucose levels, or prolonged infusion of glucose to maintain euglycemia. So this is how it has been described. Very quickly revising the physiology, well, the brain cannot make glucose, cannot even store glycogen, or cannot use alternative sources of energy. So it depends solely on glucose for the energy, and that is completely dependent on the blood to brain glucose transport maintenance. And hence, the blood glucose levels are always maintained so that the brain can get the nutrition it requires. There are counter-regulatory mechanisms, as we all know, that effectively prevent the hypoglycemic events from occurring. And these critical physiological defenses include decrease in insulin secretion itself as the glucose levels decline within the physiological range, increase in glucose secretion simultaneously, and then increase in epinephrine secretion also as the glucose levels are declining further. Increased cortisol and growth hormone secretion also help in maintaining this defense against prolonged hypoglycemia, and they prompt symptoms which increases the food intake or food ingestion behavior. So when all these defenses fail, there is a plasma glucose level lower than 70 milligrams per DL or lower than 55 milligrams. That's when the neuroglycopenia starts. And at this point, insulin secretion is suppressed virtually completely. Plasma insulin levels are less than 3 units per ml. C-peptide levels are less than 0.6 nanograms per ml. And pro-insulin levels are less than 5 picomoles per liter. Because of the capacity to increase endogenous glucose production substantially, hypoglycemia is the result of absolutely low rates of glucose production, or rates of glucose production that are low relative to high rates of glucose utilization. So this is when hypoglycemia occurs. Symptoms, I don't need to elaborate, but we all know neuroglycopenic symptoms are the worst, and that's what we want to prevent. Neurogenic autonomic are basically the perceptions that are created so that we can prevent further declining of the sugar levels. And these symptoms, the symptoms are largely sympathetic neural rather than adrenomedullary in origin. And sometimes the neurological symptoms actually take time to recover even though the glucose has been corrected. And in the worst case scenario, there has been even brain death reported. What are the causes? Now the commonest causes, and I'm giving you this preview so that we can dive deeper into what causes refractory hypoglycemia. So the commonest are probably iatrogenic causes, mainly insulin secretagogues and even alcohol. Other drugs include, the whole list is out here, but importantly, certain quinolones, quinine, chloroquine, beta blockers, even ACE inhibitors, etc. The other systemic causes include renal failure, where there may be decreased gluconeogenesis, and decreased clearance of renally excreted drugs, causing an enhanced level in the blood. Hepatic failure, again, decreased glycogenolysis and also decreased gluconeogenesis. And of course, the compromise on the functional reserve, even genetic defects, and even compromised drug metabolism. Cardiac failures, associated with hypoglycemia, sepsis, including malaria, and inanition. I also learned this new word today. This means lifeless or dull. So causes, again, important ones include hormonal deficiency like cortisol, glucagon, and epinephrine, and neoplasms. These are also very important causes of hypoglycemia and usually lead to refractory hypoglycemia. So whether it's non-islet cell tumors or mesenchymal tumors, hepatocellular carcinoma, adrenocortical tumors, carcinoid tumors, leukemia, lymphoma, all these should be suspect when we see cases of hypoglycemia that are not really occurring in patients of diabetes or are refractory in nature. Well, if we have to relook at that in a different way, in a seemingly well individual, endogenous hyperinsulinism may be due to an insulinoma, functional beta cell disorders, and that includes nasidioblastosis, or non-insulinoma pancreatogenous hypoglycemia, or even post-gastric bypass hypoglycemia. Insulin autoimmune hypoglycemia, where there are antibodies to the insulin or the insulin receptor itself, where this antibody actually stimulates the insulin secretion endogenously. And of course, overdose of insulin secreta groves. Again, accidental, surreptitious, or malicious hypoglycemia is also one way to look at it. Endocrinopathies, which I just described to you, and poisoning. Ethanol poisoning is probably one of the most commonest reasons for hypoglycemia. So this traditional classification where we look at hypoglycemia, whether it was fasting or post-meal or postprandial reactive hypoglycemia, has long been challenged. Persons with an insulinoma, which we would expect will only experience fasting hypoglycemia, often tend to experience postprandial hypoglycemia as well. And those like the post-gastric bypass patients who we expect will experience post-meal hypoglycemia may have symptoms in the fasting state as well. So again, with all this clinical heterogeneity, it has been reclassified and it is clinically recommended to just see whether the patient is seemingly well or is under the burden of hypoglycemia that is occurring. And of course, with respect to somebody who is burdened with the occurrence of hypoglycemia, one should mediate with medications. So how do we go about evaluating or work up a patient of hypoglycemia, especially a person without diabetes? In diabetes, we all are experts, so to speak. We all know how to treat that. But this is where the problem lies, because this is a refractory hypoglycemia which is not amenable to the usual dietary or even the glucose that we give IV. So hypoglycemia is rare in people who do not have drug-treated diabetes. Confirmation of the Whipple's triad is a very important step before we elaborate on investigations for the patient. And even this is just clinically, even an SMBG confirmation of hypoglycemia for Whipple's triad confirmation is more than enough at times, although most guidelines say that do a plasma glucose level at that point. So documenting this Whipple's triad is extremely important, because we may subject the patient unnecessarily to a lot of investigations when we may not have even proven that what the patient has experienced is hypoglycemia per se. The symptoms of hypoglycemia, again, we have already gone through that. And Whipple's triad is nothing but hypoglycemia that is presenting with symptoms, signs, or both consistent with hypoglycemia, a low plasma glucose concentration at the same time, and resolution of these symptoms after the plasma glucose has been corrected. So this is the triad, and this confirmation is extremely important before we go about investigating the causes. Well, we always start with a very thorough and good history taking, including looking for specific symptoms, timing and duration of the episode, aggravating and relieving factors, a physical examination and laboratory tests to rule out other illnesses, hormone deficiencies, or even neoplasms. Whipple's triad, like I said, should be confirmed. With no evident cause in a seemingly well individual, we must measure plasma glucose, insulin, C-peptide, proinsulin, and beta-hydroxybutyrate concentrations, and screen for oral hypoglycemic agents as well during an episode of spontaneous hypoglycemia, and observe the plasma glucose response to IV injection of 1 milligram glucagon in order to distinguish between the causes of hypoglycemia and the mechanisms underlying that. We must also look at the insulin antibody levels, if any. So now this is a very, this is a tough scenario clinically, and which is not always possible, or maybe not possible at all, because the patient may be, you know, in any situation when experiencing hypoglycemia, and we may not be able to subject the patient to this kind of an evaluation. So because of that, there is a wonderful protocol that has been developed, which is called the 72-hour fast, which must be conducted. So there are several protocols like this that exist from different groups or experts who have worked in this field in particular. However, this is from the Endocrine Society or internationally, and this is how the test is conducted. And best to conduct this in a hospital setting. You may start, ask the patient to start fasting at home, but then later get admitted in the hospital. Because usually patients with the Whipple's triad confirmed will not be able to complete the 72-hour fast, and that will be abandoned much earlier. 2/3 of the patient complete the test in 24 hours, 24 to 36 hours, and the remaining at 48 hours. So here what we do is discontinue all the non-essential medications. No food or drink is allowed except non-caloric beverages. And in 6 hours, we collect the samples of all the parameters that I mentioned to you. If there is if the plasma glucose is above 60 milligrams per DL, then we continue the fast and we collect the samples every 2 hours or so. If there is a hypoglycemia, meanwhile, then we increase the frequency of sampling, and further, when the glucose drops below 45 milligrams per DL with signs and symptoms, we collect the samples and send them for analysis. We also screen for oral hypoglycemic agents at this point and rescue the patient from this hypoglycemia. And the same is done even if the glucose is less than 55 milligrams per DL, with a previous episode of hypoglycemia that's been documented. So in a patient with documented fasting or postprandial endogenous hyperinsulinemic hypoglycemia, a negative screen for oral hypoglycemic agent and no circulating insulin antibodies, we conduct sophisticated procedures like the radiographic, or the, say the CT, MRI, which have 70 to 85% sensitivity to pick up the tumors, transabdominal and endoscopic sonography, and if necessary, the selective pancreatic arterial calcium injections with measurements of the hepatic venous insulin levels. These are almost very important to diagnose a case of insulinoma. And management of the specific hypoglycemic disorder should be planned with due consideration to what the patient really wants. Now, I just want you to focus on insulinomas because they are the commonest causes of hyperinsulinemic hypoglycemia in adults, clinically characterized by, say, neuroglycemia, although it can present in many other ways. And particularly, this is experienced in the fasting state, but we cannot rule out postprandially also. It affects 1 in 2,500 patient years. All ethnic groups may be equally vulnerable to it, and at any age and slightly more predominant in women. Malignant insulinomas are less common and only present in less than 10% of the patients, and they present with multiple tumors or have the multiple endocrine neoplasia type 1 or the MEN1 syndrome with a high recurrence rate. Early recurrence also means that it was not enucleated properly in the first place, and long-term survival is completely dependent on the complete removal of the tumor. The first case of hyperinsulinemic hypoglycemia due to insulinoma was successfully treated as early as 1929. So people have known about this and have been treating it for a long time. Well, the key features include that there is a complete failure of insulin secretion to fall to very low rates, even as the plasma glucose concentrations fall below the hypoglycemic thresholds, indicating that hypoglycemia is due to low production rather than high rate of glucose utilization. The levels of the different parameters are given here. Most patients fulfill these criteria within 24 to 48 hours of the 72-hour fast. And Whipple's triad inappropriately elevated high plasma, elevated plasma insulin, C-peptide and proinsulin levels, and no detectable oral hypoglycemic agent levels during fasting hypoglycemia, and no circulating antibodies to insulin are all indicative of insulinoma. Amongst all the investigations I just told you, and the differential diagnosis commonest is NIPHS. I'll just go through that in a minute, and mesoblastoma. Well, surgical resection is a very well accepted mode of therapy for insulinoma. Now, what is NIPHS, which is non-insulinoma pancreatogenous hypoglycemia syndrome, again characterized by spells of neuroglycopenia and less common than insulinoma, but predominantly seen in men. It differs from insulinoma by the timing of hypoglycemia occurrence. This is usually postprandial or reactive in nature, and this consists of diffuse pancreatic abnormality with islet involvement with mesoblastosis. And because radiological investigations may not always help us, the most recommended test for NIPHS is the selective pancreatic arterial calcium injections. I'm not going to go through the details for want of time. And again, there's no recommended path for NIPHS treatment. Partial pancreatectomy has helped, but at the same time, even it can be managed medically if the patient is in a good general condition. Again, for postprandial or the gastric bypass related hypoglycemia and other such, I'll take 15 minutes more. So, and other such hypoglycemia events, they have a mixed meal diagnostic test, which is similar to the 72-hour fasting test. And this has, again, different protocols being used by different experts and groups. The differential diagnosis, again, this has been quite beautifully described in this paper by Cryer, PE et al. And this is from the Endocrine Society Clinical Practice Guideline, where different levels of the different hormones has been given and what it really indicates. Because the differential diagnosis of hyperinsulinemic hypoglycemia and the absence of diabetes can be quite a confusing clinical picture. Again, the entire table is out here, and on the right side, you can see the diagnostic interpretation. So it's a lovely paper if you want to go through that, to if you have a case like that. And very quickly, I want to tell you that even last year, they presented this poster where they described the sitagliptin-induced refractory hypoglycemia in a patient of diabetic kidney disease. The patient was dialyzed, and the internist did not realize that the patient was on sitagliptin full dose, and the patient had prolonged and profound hypoglycemia, making it a case of refractory hypoglycemia, and they eventually treated it with IV dextrose and other supportive treatment. The patient recovered, and that's why they presented this, that all hospital internists should know what all can cause this kind of hypoglycemia. Again, neonatal refractory hypoglycemia is also a common entity, although not as common as the adult one. And several causes are given here, which we have gone through earlier as well. Diagnostic approaches are available all over, especially from the Mayo Clinic or the Endocrine Society Practice Guideline. And again, it's the same thing that I've described, that we start with confirmation of the Whipple's triad, go through the 72-hour fasting test, look at all the levels of the hormones, and then decide one by one what it narrows down to. Management, well, it can be managed medically with how we manage iatrogenic hypoglycemia, and in special cases we need dextrose. Again, we are all familiar with this, so I will not go through the details of this, but I want to talk to you about, again, glucagon is also an important aspect that our patients should know. Although it's a very expensive treatment at the moment, we also have nasal sprays of glucagon available, and patients should be taught, especially type 1 diabetes patients and those of refractory hypoglycemia, because they seem to be responding well to glucagon. Several papers have been published in this with this experience, and glucagon remains an important aspect of therapy. Octreotide, on the other hand, is a known management line for those suffering from sulfonylurea-induced hypoglycemia in particular. And let me tell you how it works. It's an analog of somatostatin and used for patients with refractory hypoglycemia, and a potent inhibitor. If you look at this diagram, you can see that this is the somatostatin 2 receptor where it binds octreotide, and it inhibits this is on the pancreatic beta cell surface, and it blocks the calcium influx which is required for insulin secretion. So this is how it blocks the sulfonylurea receptor and brings about the restoration of glucose levels. Steroids cannot be used in that aspect, because steroids, even though are used widely in other forms of hypoglycemia rescue, but they will not help us with sulfonylurea induced hypoglycemia. Again, steroids.
Sorry to interrupt you,
yeah, I'm just completing. Again, low dose steroids also can be used in these patients of refractory hypoglycemia, especially where diagnosis has been a challenge. Most of them respond well, and adrenocortical insufficiency also should be ruled out as one of the diagnostic measures. These are again two agents commonly used in cancer therapy, sirolimus and tacrolimus, but they have been tried with varying degree of success in refractory hypoglycemia as well. The most important aspect is maybe localizing the tumor and surgically resecting the same. So thank you to all of you, but in particular, this is my brainstorming team for refractory hypoglycemia. I've had a couple of difficult cases, and I've shared experiences with them all who hold special interest in this field. So again, thank you very much for this patient hearing and this wonderful opportunity.